I would like to invite Feda to the podium.
Thank you very much. Well, if it's good enough. I prepared like a whole written speech, and then Russians put this veto the other day, so I just crossed it, just come up with something else. So life has to go on. So my story, unfortunately, it's a very common story in Bosnia. You know, basically, I was 14 when the war started. My parents just kind of were able to kind of smell the air, smell the war in the air. So they sent me to my aunt, to Croatia. So me and my sister, was 14, she was like second grade. And, you know, I had no idea that I was actually giving my mother a final goodbye. You know. So when I was in Croatia, we were only 100 miles away from my hometown. But for all practical purposes, it was like a world away. There was absolute communication blockade. Had no idea what was going on. And well, it turns out that the destiny of my parents was actually worse than my most pessimistic nightmare. I mean, at the time we thought we were going away for a couple of weeks and somehow we'd come back after, you know, things settled down. My mother was basically enslaved in one of these concentration camps. Omarska is actually one of the Auschwitz of Bosnia. And she got murdered, and my father was also imprisoned in another concentration camp, Ternopil. So I come from a town that had like 20 to 30,000 people called Kozarac. Every single citizen of that town was imprisoned in one of these concentration camps. And probably every fifth person that I can think of is not alive today. They've been murdered. So, Srebrenica is a symbol of Bosnian genocide, but there are very many in the other places as well. And so that's very unfortunate. So about 10 years later, my mother's remains were found in one of these mass graves, DNA identification. I guess I was lucky to actually have a grave site and a place where we can go and visit. But 20 years later, they're still finding new mass graves, like the one called in this mine, Tomasica. It's just dug out hundreds of people. So 20 years later, all this evidence is mounting, and Serbian politicians are continuously denying this. They're either denying it or they're sort of watering it down to a point where it's almost like an equal blame, you know. And it's you know, disgusting, really. It's very difficult to listen to that. I mean, denying these genocides is almost like, you know, doing them all over again, you know, like kind of twisting the knife in your back. So, a lot of these leaders, of course, I always feel that many of them are just saying, I mean, they're kind of acknowledging some of these events now just because they feel like they have to sort of meet these minimum requirements to enter the European Union. But otherwise, they're pretty much proud of their predecessors, Ratko Mladic and Karadzic, right? So when you sort of look at it from that point of view, it almost seems hopeless, like hopeless for the country, because we do need to integrate the country if we want to keep Bosnia as one nation, right? So, well, I try to kind of look at it, you know, with a more bright light and try to say, well, okay, you can look at it this way. In the last 20 years, there was like 10 years ago, they wouldn't even talk about genocide. Well, today you'll have their leaders every once in a while show up at these memorials, maybe put flowers, right? So there is some improvement, right? So in I'd like to remind people that, say, in 1970, about 25 years later, after the World War II ended, German Chancellor Willy Brandt actually kind of dropped on his knees in Warsaw and Poland at one of these Holocaust memorials. And I think by many people, it was like considered as one of the sort of most genuine apologies for the Holocaust. So it took 25 years even for Germans to do it, right? So maybe we can expect something in the next 5-6 years from Serbian leadership. So Bosnians really, I mean, I personally really need this sort of admission of wrongdoing by the Serbian leadership. I really feel like they ought to stop denying this genocide. They really gotta, take some responsibility, think about maybe about some compensation for the victims and so on. So now, on the other hand, I think that the whole civilized world also wants Serbia to kind of admit these atrocities as well, in the full meaning of the word genocide, because they want to integrate them into the world society and try to incorporate them into the European Union. I mean, people want to do it, but you just can't do it because they have to come to terms, take responsibility, and so on. So I guess what I see for the future, there is some common ground, there is some hope. And the hope is that we want them to admit this. We can't even begin to talk about forgiveness until they admit what they've done. And it's in actually their economic interest and their national interest to kind of become a reputable member of the world community and the European Union. So I see that somewhere down the road, we kind of have common interests. They're just going to take a little bit of time. Now, on the other hand, I believe that, can we sort of move beyond the genocide? This was one of the questions here. And I'd say it's hard to move beyond genocide. Like, as long as the last person who remembers this genocide, they will not be able to sort of move beyond. But we can definitely, learn some things from it, right? We could, try to become even better citizens of this country and back in Bosnia as well. We can sort of try to be exemplary nation, right? We have experienced this something in our own skin, and now we can be example to the world about human rights, about respecting minorities, about so maybe that way we can we sort of need to show the world that we're sort of worthy fighting for, if you know what I mean. So I will give you actually one example. So we've been kind of known in Yugoslavia, Bosnians have been known to be most ethnically and religiously sort of tolerant people. And so I think we can expand that here in the United States. There was an example maybe last year where I, heard some people trying to kind of unify against, there was a law against same-sex marriage in this state, right? There was very few people, but I heard them saying we need to kind of join up with some churches over here and try to pass this prohibition of same-sex marriage in the state. And I actually got quite offended by that, because I felt like my mother was murdered in this war just because she was fighting for some sort of basic human rights in her country, right? And now we've come to the United States through this, we've been accepted by Americans like we were born here, given all opportunities to succeed, and now we have some voices saying now we as the majority, right, are going to kind of go on to this minority of LGBT people and try to kind of impose our will how they should live their life. That just that was extremely difficult for me. So I kind of voiced my opinion around here. So, I mean, it's okay to have your own feelings and teach your own family how, you know, your children should be raised and what kind of a relationship they should be in, but try not to impose that on other people. So that would be a lesson for all of us here, that every time we think about any of our actions, we have to make sure that we're not imposing our will on somebody else. Respect freedom of other people. Basically, let everybody live their life the way they want to live their life. And you live your life the way you want to live your life. So maybe even back in Bosnia, you know, maybe we can start being you know, even more tolerant. Like, sometimes we have issues with Roma people or Gypsy people, right? It's been known. You know, let Serbians, you know, if they want to beat their up their Roma people, that's fine. We should really welcome them. You know, if we have a gay parade in Sarajevo, we should really welcome it, right? If Serbs want to beat them up, well, that's their problem. So we need to kind of start some kind of healthy competition with Serbs on maybe really being kind of exemplary, you know, nation. Then, on the other hand, I do believe that the key to really reconciliation in the long term is economic prosperity, right? I mean, busy and prosperous people, they have no time to hate. This is what I really believe in. So maybe we can try to be economic examples to Serbs, you know. You know, we can replace their hate for us with respect by doing something. So what can we do from here, for example, right? Many of us have gained a lot of expertise in many different fields, you know. Maybe we can form some kind of economic advisory council where a local politician from Bosnia maybe can, you know, give us a call and see if we can form some experts to advise them on something, right? Or better yet, maybe we can groom a politician from here, from this community or some other community in the United States, and maybe have them go run for office and we support them with money and try to make this sort of change go a little bit faster, right? So how do we, you know, we can support somebody, and because ultimately our future lies in basically European integration, right? If we go somehow get into European Union in the package, I do believe that this reconciliation will kind of go on a fast track. And I mean, unfortunately, we have a more difficult job here. We're trying to keep Bosnia as one unit. We're trying to preserve it, where Serbs are trying to destroy it. So they have a lot easier task to do. So we have to work extra hard to keep this country together, right? And I would re-emphasize Senada's point here about education. We have been sort of pulled back 10, 20 years with this war, and many of us here have opportunities to go to school, educate our children, and we have to really spring back, work twice as hard to kind of make up for some of that time. And so we should use this example of Srebrenica to, you know, motivate your kids to do better in school, to volunteer more, to be better citizens. And I really commend some of the organizers here to organize an event like this. So we should let this be a motivation to, you know, another young person here to maybe start something like, you know, Economic Advisory Council or maybe some kind of campaign to try to propel a candidate for the next election or something like that. So yeah, with that thought, I would kind of leave you thinking, and hopefully somebody gets inspired by that. That's it, thank you.